This one started recording. Good morning to all of you and welcome to the GHI class 2 of Odisha State Open University. And today's as per the schedule, our resource person again, Ms. Tripti Diu, assistant professor in University of Delhi. Welcome, madam. We are covering the first block of G2 today, that is the conquest of the Britishers and the expansion of the British Raj. As far as the conquest of the British is concerned, though they came in the early part of the 17th century, but till 1750 they never started their expansion policy, and with the around 7 they first tried to conquer the southern part slowly, and during the rule of the Nawabs of Murshidabad in 1757 with the Battle of Palassi, their expansion policy was started very rapidly. Subsequently, in the Battle of Bakshar in 1764, with the defeat of Mir Qasim Shah Shujauddaulah and Shah Alam, now the Britishers concretely established their empire and the expansion policy was rapidly implemented. After that, there was a war between the Anglo-Mysore Wars and Anglo-Maratha Wars, where the Britishers were the victorious, and subsequently the major power of the then India was the Mysores and the Maratha, they defeated by them. The expansion policy was not only confined to the war and conquest, they also used the diplomatic policies like the subsidiary alliance and doctrine of labs. And today's class will be surrounding all these topics. And with this brief introduction, now I request Ms. Tripti Diu to please start the lecture. Ms. Diu.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Sakir. Should I start?
Yes.
Okay. I think Sukuta Sethi has started presenting.
Before starting the lecturer, I request my learners, please don't share your screen because it will create problem for the resource person to show her slides, and it will be again problematic for you people because you will not properly understand the class through the PowerPoint presentation. Thank you. Okay, madam, you can start now.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Sakir, for giving us a brief about what we are going to be studying today. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, students. Thank you for joining the session today, the lecture session today. And we're going to be discussing a couple of things today related to the modern Indian period. And I'm Tripti Deo, and I've been with you for a little while now. And I'm quite excited to take this lecture with all of you. I'm going to be sharing my screen, and that's when I'm going to start with my lecture. I hope my screen is visible. I think it is. Yes. So today we आज हम बातचीत करेंगे ब्रिटिश रूल की. जब ब्रिटिश रूल आया, उपनिवेश पीरियड जब चालू हुआ इंडिया का, कॉलोनियल पीरियड चालू हुआ, और ये पीरियड जो हम डिस्कशन करेंगे वो है 1750 टू 1950. सो वी ऑल, आई थिंक मोस्ट ऑफ द स्टूडेंट्स आर फ्रॉम द सेकेंड सेमेस्टर BA honors, and you've opted for GE elective course. This is the History of India Part 2, and we will be discussing the Block 1. So we welcome all of you today for the lecture. Now there'll be three broad themes that we will be discussing today. One will be the Battle of Plassey, which took place in 1757, and the conquest of Bengal, the subsequent conquest of Bengal. Of course, we will be dealing with Battle of Buxar also, and how gradually, why gradually Bengal became important, and why British from the East India Company, it wanted to take direct control of this region. And of course, gradually it took control of the entire Indian subcontinent. So we will see that happening in this particular, we will see that discussion in this particular segment. The second important region is the Mysore and Maharashtra. So we will be studying this through how and why were British interested in Mysore and Maharashtra. Now again, keep these regions in mind. Today I haven't been able to get you the map, but I'm sure you all of you can know where is Bengal, where is Odisha, of course, the state that we all belong to, Bihar, Mysore, and Maharashtra. So please keep all these states in your mind in terms of the map of India. We will also be looking at expansion through diplomacy. Diplomacy मतलब कि कैसे जो ब्रिटिश गवर्नमेंट है वो जो प्रिंसली स्टेट्स हैं, जो स्टेट्स हैं इंडिया के नेटिव स्टेट्स हैं उनके साथ क्या डील कर रही है पॉलिटिकली, क्या राजनीतिक स्तर पे वो क्या डिप्लोमेसी कर रही है, क्या बातचीत चल रहा है, कैसे वो अपने अधीन कर रही है इन रीजन्स को ब्रिटिश. सो एक्सपेंशन थ्रू डिप्लोमेसी. नाउ ऑफकोर्स दिस डिप्लोमेसी इज गोइंग टू फेवर द ब्रिटिशर्स. ये डिप्लोमेसी आज की डिप्लोमेसी की बात नहीं है जिसमें दोनों स्टेट, अगर आज की बात किया जाए डिप्लोमेसी के बारे में, पॉलिटिकल डिप्लोमेसी, तो उसमें दो स्टेट्स या जो भी एंगेज कर रहा है इस डिप्लोमेसी में दोनों बेनिफिट करते हैं. बट इस डिप्लोमेसी की जो बात करेंगे हम in the 19th and the 20th century, हम देखेंगे कि ये जो डिप्लोमेसी है ये ब्रिटिशर्स को बेनिफिट कर रही है. सब्सिडरी अलायंस की बात करेंगे हम. वी विल ऑल्सो डिस्कस डॉक्ट्रीन ऑफ लैप्स. सो लेट मी बिगिन विद द फर्स्ट टॉपिक. I'm sure I am, you know, all of you would know ki Battle of Plassey kya tha. Main ek baat aapse abhi outset mein bolna chahungi ki jab hum Bengal ki baat kar rahe hain, so Bengal is not what is present Bengal. When I say Bengal, it is a Bengal province. ठीक है, बंगाल प्रोविंस जो है उसमें बिहार, बंगाल और उड़ीसा, ये तीनों स्टेट्स इन्वॉल्व्ड हैं. ब्रिटिशर्स के पीरियड, ब्रिटिश पीरियड में ये एक बड़ा प्रोविंस था. और इस प्रोविंस की जब हम बात कर रहे हैं तो फिर इस प्रोविंस की जो हम बात करेंगे वो हम ये तीनों स्टेट्स को मद्देनजर रखेंगे. सो व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट कॉन्क्वेस्ट ऑफ बंगाल, प्लीज कीप द रीजन्स इन माइंड. आई एम गोइंग टू बी डिस्कसिंग बंगाल, बिहार एंड उड़ीसा, इट्स द बंगाल प्रोविंस, राइट? बट यस, बैटल ऑफ प्लासी स्पेसिफिकली हैपन इन बंगाल, द प्रेजेंट डे बंगाल. Now let's see what this Bengal was before the British conquest. Now when I Bengal jo tha British conquest se pehle, you have to understand that there was ideology of mercantilism. Bengal jo tha wo ek hunting ground bana hua tha European trading companies ke liye. Bengal was the hunting ground for European trading companies. When I say European trading companies, I just don't mean the English European trading company. डच भी है, फ्रेंच भी है, पोर्चुगीज भी है, ये भी, ये सारी जो यूरोपियन कंट्रीज हैं, ये सारी यूरोपियन कंट्रीज जो हैं वो इनके अपनी ट्रेडिंग कंपनीज हैं, ठीक है? और इन ट्रेडिंग कंपनीज के जो है वो बंगाल में इंटरेस्टेड हैं. क्यों इंटरेस्टेड है? क्योंकि बंगाल एज अ रीजन वॉज द रिचेस्ट प्रोविंस इन द इंडियन सब कॉन्टिनेंट. And many foreign travelers like Bernier and all have described this region in a very it is very rich, very prosperous, very fertile. The resources are resources are very rich in its resources. So Bengal was seen as that kind of a region. And English East India Company, and I'm going to be using EIC as a abbreviated form of English East India Company from now, it set up its first factory in the eastern part of India. Mein pehla factory jo English East India Company ne set up kiya tha wo kiya tha 1633 at Balasore. And this was again Balasore was under the Bengal province, because I've already said that the Bengal province consisted of Bengal, Bihar and Odisha. Okay, and Bengal goods like rice, saltpeter, indigo, pepper, silk, cotton, textiles, sugar, etc. comprised nearly 60% of British imports from Asia in the 18th century. So these were goods that Britishers and other European companies, trading companies, were interested in. They were interested in Bengal for these specific goods. And of course, they were trading in other goods also, but these were goods that they really profited from. And they were interested in Bengal for these reasons. Now, the English East India Company allowed free trade in Bengal. It was allowed free trade in Bengal against annual payment of ₹3,000 to the Mughal emperor. So, main aapko ek baat bata dun ki jo मुगल्स और ब्रिटिशर्स के बीच में जो फरमान मुगल्स जो है वो फरमान दे चुके थे ऑलरेडी 17 सेंचुरी से ही चला आ रहा है कि दे हैव बीन गिवन फरमान्स दे बीन गिवन ऑर्डर्स फॉर सर्टन काइंड ऑफ ट्रेड, फ्री ट्रेड और सर्टन काइंड ऑफ ट्रेड इन द पोर्ट्स ऑफ द मुगल पोर्ट्स बेसिकली सूरत में, बंगाल में. So these were all of these regions are still under Mughal control. Let's not forget that. So the Mughal emperor is the head, right? Now Bengal is still not independent right now. Bengal is not independent. Bengal is still under the Mughal emperor, and the Mughal emperor gives farmans to the trading companies कि आप यहाँ आके trade कीजिए. Of course उस फरमान के अपने कंडीशन है, अपने डिटर्मिनेंस है, बट वॉट यू हैव टू रियली अंडरस्टैंड इज दैट दीज फरमान और परमिशन वर बींग गिवन बाय द मुगल एम्परर, राइट? सो द पेमेंट ऑफ ₹3,000 वॉज गिवन टू द मुगल एम्परर एंड एन इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी वॉज अलाउड फ्री ट्रेड इन बंगाल. नाउ दैट्स अ बिग थिंग. या नाउ द ब्रिटिश एम्परर सॉरी द मुगल एम्परर हैज गिवन दिस फरमान, बट द Bengal governor, for example, at this point of time, Murshid Kuli Khan, was not very happy with it because a lot of revenue was being lost. Free trade से क्या होता है? आप revenue जो region है उसमें आप revenue collect नहीं कर सकते हो traders. बहुत सारी चीजें हैं उसको free trade में. But what happens is the state loses its revenue, which is coming from trade. Right, so therefore you have to understand that English East India Company was allowed free trade in Bengal, and Murshid Kuli Khan and the governors, later governors, were not very happy with this, and this was a major reason for the conflict that we will see it happening in the subsequent period. Provincial governors who were called Nawab, who was called the Nawab in Bengal, these provincial governors, when I'm saying it is a provincial governor of the Mughal Emperor. Mughal Empire was divided into different provinces. Bengal was one of the province. और बंगाल को मैनेज करने के लिए मुगल एम्परर ने एक गवर्नर वहां पे रखा. वो गवर्नर को हम प्रोविंशियल गवर्नर कहते हैं. इन बंगाल इट ही वाज कॉल्ड, ही वाज गिवन द टाइटल, ही वाज रेफर्ड टू एज द नवाब. नाउ प्रोविंशियल गवर्नर नवाब्स वर कंपेल्ड compelled foreign traders to pay inland duties. Now, of course, like I told you, that provincial governors would not be very happy agar unke region mein trade allow kar diya aur wo bhi free trade. So they insisted the foreign traders to pay inland duties. All right, duty free trade would mean revenue loss to the provincial government. I've already explained this point. So this Britishers were there in Bengal, East India Company and other companies were there in Bengal for trade, for commercial purpose. Right, so the first conflict that emerged was on the commercial. It was related to commerce. It was related to trade. It was related to the loss of revenue which the Indian states, the Bengal region, had to bear. Provincial government also dependent on support of powerful elements in local aristocracy for smooth functioning of the government. Now you have to also understand that Bengal as a region had other complications. What was the complication? The provincial government governor hai jo, he was dependent on the support of powerful elements in the local aristocracy for smooth functioning of the government. So he was dependent on other people, other elite groups in the region, other zamindars in the region. Okay, and the foreign power, especially the English East India Company, took advantage of this weakness of the government. So East India Company understood that the Bengal Nawab, the provincial governor, is dependent on these people, on these elites, on these zamindars. So now the British could align with them to conspire against the Nawab, and that's what exactly happened in Bengal. We will see that later. So Bengal as a region was very very important for Mughals and later for the British, but Bengal had its own complications. It had its own ways of functioning. The provincial governor was strong, but then provincial governor jo hai wo dependent hai kis pe, zamindars pe and other elite groups. So let's see that how British conquered Bengal. Conquest kaise hua? 1757 or 1765 ke beech mein. Siddharth-ud-Daulah assumed the throne of Bengal in 1765 amidst challenges thrown by his relatives. These later connived with English East India Company, which became the cause of conflict between EIC and the young Nawab. The Nawab wanted to make changes in the internal administration, but it was resented by the powerful aristocracy. An East India Company started interfering in the politics of Bengal. So in these 5-6 points that I've just read out to you from my slide, I have told you that how Siraj-ud-Daula was Nawab bana, but bahut challenges se wo challenges usko face karne pade apne relatives se. He was not that, it was not that he was accepted by everybody very happily. और जो लोग परेशान थे कि सिराजुद्दौला बंगाल का नवाब बन गया है, उसके साथ इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी ने दोस्ती कर ली, और वो दोस्ती जो है वो इसलिए की जिससे कि सिराजुद्दौला को हराया जा सके. ठीक है, नवाब जो है सिराजुद्दौला, ही आल्सो वांटेड टू मेक सम चेंजेस इन द एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन बिकॉज अ लॉट वॉज गोइंग रॉन्ग, बट ये जो पावरफुल एरिस्टोक्रेसी है, एलीट ग्रुप है, इट वॉजंट टू हैप्पी, इट रिजेंटेड इट. An East India Company therefore got the ticket to interfere in Bengal politics. So East India Company gradually bahut overconfidence mein aake usne bahut sare fortifications bhi banaye Calcutta mein. East India Company made some fortifications around Calcutta without the permission of Nawab. Siraj-ud-Daula ke permission ke bina East India Company jo hai wo building bana rahi hai port pe. और जब नवाब ने कहा कि इसको डिमोलिश करो, तो ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी ने बोला कि नहीं, हम नहीं डिमोलिश करेंगे. सो व्हेन ऑर्डर टू डिमोलिश, इट रिफ्यूज्ड. मुगल एम्परर फारूक सियर इन 1717 एक्सटेंडेड ट्रेड प्रिविलेजेस टू द ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी इन बंगाल. कंपनी परमिटेड टू कंडक्ट ड्यूटी फ्री ट्रेड फॉर इट्स ऑफिशियल गुड्स कॉज्ड लॉस ऑफ गवर्नमेंट एंड हार्डशिप्स टू लोकल मर्चेंट्स. सो अगेन मुगल एम्परर जो है वो फरमान दिए जा रहा था. मैंने बताया कि 17th-18th सेंचुरी में मुगल एम्परर फरमान दे रहे हैं टू ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी टू ट्रेड, एंड अ लॉट ऑफ कंसेशंस वर गिवन, आप ट्रेड पे टैक्स मत दीजिए एंड ऑल ऑफ दैट. सो नाउ अगेन दिस हैज कॉज्ड गवर्नमेंट लॉस ऑफ रेवेन्यू एंड हार्डशिप्स टू द लोकल मर्चेंट्स, एंड ऑन टॉप ऑफ इट कैलकटा के में फोर्टिफिकेशन ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी बना रही है. सो ऑल ऑफ दिस was not a very happy situation. The Nawab of Bengal fought a battle which was called the Battle of Plassey in June 1757. A conspiracy between East India Company and the Nawab's officials, and this conspiracy helped in English winning the battle. So कहा जाता है कि Battle of Plassey जो है वो English या British की military power के कारण नहीं जीता गया था, but it was because English East India Company ne conspire kiya tha aur logo ke sath jo ki Siraj-ud-Daula ko harana chahte hain. So it was a conspiracy between East India Company and Nawab's officials, the elite groups, right? wo dosti karke unhone wo dono dosti karke Siraj-ud-Daula ko haraya gaya. After Siraj-ud-Daula, Mir Jafar was installed on the throne, and he was rewarded by the company lavishly. He rewarded the company lavishly. In fact, a lot of money he gave to the company because Mir Jafar was installed by the company on the throne, or throne in the sense on the throne of Bengal, as a provincial governor. Gave zamindari rights of some districts of Bengal. So now you see, zamindari rights gradually Bengal ke bahut sare regions ki shuruaat mein kuch regions ki. जो नवाब है बंगाल का वो इट इज लेटिंग आउट टू द ब्रिटिशर्स. मीर जाफर इंस्टॉल्ड ऑन द थ्रोन रिवॉर्डेड द कंपनी लैविशली एंड गेव जमींदारी राइट्स ऑफ सम डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स टू बंगाल ऑफ बंगाल. मीर काजिम अ स्ट्रॉन्ग रूलर, मीर जाफर के बाद मीर काजिम आए. मीर काजिम अ स्ट्रॉन्ग रूलर वॉन्टेड टू रिफॉर्म हिज एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन एंड फ्री बंगाल फ्रॉम क्लचेस ऑफ ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी. ही फॉर्म्ड एन अलायंस विद मुगल एम्परर शाह आलम टू Nawab of Awadh, Shuja-ud-Daula, to fight East India Company, which was called the Battle of Buxar in 1764. Now, after Battle of Buxar, what became the fact was that it made English East India Company the real masters of Bengal. Okay, so and how the Battle of Buxar happened and all of that, please refer to your your learning material. उसमें काफी डिटेल में दिया हुआ है कि कैसे इंग्लिश ने जब पटना पे अटैक किया तो वो एक पॉइंट हो गया जब नवाब जो है बंगाल का, उसने उसने उस मोमेंट पे बैटल डिक्लेयर कर दिया बक्सर रीजन, बक्सर जो है वो बक्सर इज अ रीजन इन बिहार, वहाँ ये बैटल फाइट हुआ था। एंड बंगाल नवाब के साथ जो थे वो थे शाह आलम टू, हु वाज द मुगल एम्परर, द नवाब ऑफ अवध शुजाउद्दौला। सो बेसिकली शुजाउद्दौला, शाह आलम टू एंड मीर काजिम, दे वर ऑन वन साइड एंड इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी वाज ऑन द अदर साइड। ऑफ कोर्स वी नो दैट इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी वन दिस बैटल एंड इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी बिकेम द रियल मास्टर्स ऑफ बंगाल। ट्रीटी ऑफ अलाहाबाद साइन की गई 1765 में और ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी को अपॉइंट किया गया एज दीवान ऑफ बिहार, बंगाल एंड उड़ीसा, राइट। द नवाब ऑफ बंगाल रिटेन्ड ऑफिस ऑफ निजाम but they had to submit to company interventions in matters of appointment and dismissal of officers etc. so you see that almost full-fledgedly English East India Company is now take has now taken control over the region of Bengal. जमींदारी राइट्स की जब बात करते हैं, जमींदारी राइट्स मतलब कि वहां से रेवेन्यू आप कलेक्ट कर सकते हो, तो रेवेन्यू कैन बी कलेक्टेड, हु कैन कलेक्ट द रेवेन्यू, द ब्रिटिशर्स, बिकॉज इट हैज द जमींदारी राइट्स, द दीवानी राइट्स, right? So it was appointed, East India Company was appointed as a Diwan of Bengal, Bihar and Odisha. And the Nawab hai, he has accepted the sovereignty or the superiority of English East India Company. It had to submit to the company. And East India Company was now directly interfering in appointments, dismissals and other matters, important matters of the state of Bengal. Okay, so this is briefly about what was happening in Bengal from 1757 to 1765. Now let's understand that kya politically transform ho raha hai, rajnitik star pe kya transformation ho rahi hai, what is the political transformation that one is seeing at this point of time. Abhi tak jo maine baat cheet ki thi, I had spoken to you about the events jo us samay हो रहे थे, but उसके political impact क्या था, या political transformation अगर हो भी रहा है तो वो उसका नेचर क्या है, व्हाट इज द सिग्निफिकेंस। हिस्टोरियंस ने इस पे काफी काम किया है, हिस्टोरियंस हैव टर्म्ड दिस पीरियड ऑफ बंगाल फ्रॉम 1757 टू 1765 एज अ पीरियड ऑफ पॉलिटिकल रेवोल्यूशन, राइट, दे यूज द वर्ड पॉलिटिकल रेवोल्यूशन। नाउ ओपिनियंस ऑफ कोर्स आर डिवाइडेड अमंग हिस्टोरियंस, कोई अग्री करता है कि ये पॉलिटिकल रेवोल्यूशन, राजनीतिक क्रांति आप इसमें इसको हिंदी में कहेंगे, कि पॉलिटिकल रेवोल्यूशन कहा है, कोई कुछ हिस्टोरियंस इसको पॉलिटिकल रेवोल्यूशन नहीं मानते। सम रेफर दिस एज पॉलिटिकल रेवोल्यूशन टू पर्सनल इनकॉम्पिटेंस एंड फेलियर्स ऑफ नवाब ऑफ बंगाल। अगर ये पॉलिटिकल रेवोल्यूशन है भी, कुछ हिस्टोरियंस इसको, इसका रीजन जो मानते हैं इस रेवोल्यूशन का और इस ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन का, वो मानते हैं पर्सनल इनकॉम्पिटेंस, मतलब आप निजी स्तर पे हैंडल नहीं कर पाए, इनकॉम्पिटेंट थे, कौन थे, नवाब ऑफ बंगाल एंड फेलियर्स ऑफ नवाब ऑफ बंगाल। सम आर्ग्यू दैट प्राइवेट इंटरेस्ट ऑफ एम्प्लॉयज ऑफ द ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी प्रोवोक द कॉन्फ्लिक्ट्स विद द नवाब। एक चीज मैं आपको बताना भूल गई, जो अभी मैं आपको बताऊंगी, कि ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी जो है वो मर्चेंट्स की है, मर्चेंट्स ने ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी बनाई हुई है, एक ब्रिटिश मर्चेंट्स, इंग्लिश मर्चेंट्स। अब ये इंग्लिश मर्चेंट्स जो हैं वो एक तो ऑफिशियल ट्रेड कर रहे हैं, इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी, ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी की तरफ से ट्रेड कर रहे हैं, और वो पर्सनल कैपेसिटी में भी काफी ट्रेड कर रहे हैं, निजी स्तर पर पर्सनल ट्रेड भी कर रहे हैं और ऑफिशियल ट्रेड भी कर रहे हैं। और ये जो निजी, इनका जो प्राइवेट इंटरेस्ट है इन मर्चेंट्स का, ब्रिटिश मर्चेंट्स का, वो काफी हद तक रीजन था इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी और नवाब ऑफ बंगाल की कॉन्फ्लिक्ट का। बिकॉज आप जब आप फरमान फ्री ट्रेड बोल रहे हैं, तो आप फ्री ट्रेड ऑफिशियल ट्रेड पे बोल दे रहे हैं, अगर आप व्हेन यू गिविंग एन ऑर्डर टू कंडक्ट फ्री ट्रेड इन योर स्टेट, द फ्री ट्रेड इज नॉट ऑन योर पर्सनल ट्रेड दैट यू आर डूइंग, it's the official trade that you're doing. But what the East India Company merchants and traders did were, they were also conducting personal trade, private trade. Now this private trade was, did not have permission of free trade, but then it was being done, and they did not pay taxes, or they did not pay the levies that they had to pay on the trade on their private trade also. So this was a major reason for the conflict that Nawabs had with the East India Company. Some argue that private interest of the employees of East India Company is a very important point that provoked the conflict with the Nawabs. Some also argue that the East India Company created conditions to initiate hostility with the Nawabs and also took advantage of the prevailing political condition of Bengal. कुछ हिस्टोरियंस का कहना है दैट ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी जो है उसने एक कंडीशन एक वातावरण क्रिएट कर दिया कंडीशन क्रिएट की जो हॉस्टिलिटी बढ़ाई हॉस्टिलिटी मतलब टेंशंस बढ़ाया किसके बीच में नवाब और ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी जानबूझ के टेंशंस बढ़ा रहे हैं जिससे कि वो इस टेंशंस का ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी इन टेंशंस का एडवांटेज ले सके दे कैन टेक एडवांटेज ऑफ दीज tensions and weaknesses and take control of the political condition in Bengal. Pehla jo battle tha, battle of Plassey, it was, I told you, was more of a conspiracy between the British East India Company and the elites of Bengal against the Nawab. So it was also more about the Nawab's weaknesses with the other or tensions with the other groups and this political condition of Bengal the East India Company made it made use of okay now significance of British success now it's known far and wide that 1764 after Battle of Buxar it was pretty clear that East India Company has become the real masters of Bengal right why because East India Company now established a dual government through the system of dual government. Now, again, there's a lot that I would like to discuss on the dual government aspect, but I would request all of you to please go back to your learning material and see what this dual government was. Now, this basically dual government is about having certain rights. Both, like I told you, that Diwani and the Nizami rights, Nawab, both were taken by the Britishers gradually, and the administration of Bengal became inefficient, corrupt, and it caused hardship to the population of Bengal. So we will also see that now gradually, from the time British became successful on Bengal and controlling Bengal. The degeneration of that area started because British starts taking control of that region directly, it is now controlling the population of Bengal, and it is not interested in taking care of the people there, but rather because British was a colonial power, uska interest commercial hai, financial hai, materialistic hai, to uske karan kya hoga? Exploitation hoga. Exploitation किसका होगा? People of Bengal, people of the Bengal province, right? Hardships of Bengal will now start. We will see it gradually कि वहाँ पे permanent settlement system को लागू किया जाता है. We will see all of that. So up now with after 1764, we see that there was degeneration of the area of Bengal because it directly came under the control of the British power. Now let's move to the conquest of Mysore and Maharashtra. Now these were different regions. Let's move our attention now from the Bengal province to the areas of Mysore and Maharashtra. Now before going further, before going on my discussion on Mysore and Maharashtra, just would like to share about four points on the India in the 18th century. When I say 18th century, I mean the period of 1700 to 1799. We have seen Battle of Plassey and Buxar taking place in this period, but broadly in these regions of Mysore, Maharashtra, and otherwise in the entire Indian subcontinent, what is happening in the 18th century? Now, in the 18th century, what was happening was there were intricate power struggles between various powers. Various powers, I mean that between various regional powers. Okay, so intricate power struggles, and I mean is ki chote chote baaton pe, chote chote reasons pe, and kafi ulje hui struggles jo hai, wo it is happening between various powers, not only between colonial power and Indian state. सिर्फ इंडियन स्टेट्स जो डिफरेंट इंडियन स्टेट्स हैं और ब्रिटिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी या ब्रिटिश पावर सिर्फ इन दोनों के बीच में ही लड़ाइयां नहीं हो रही है बट ऑल्सो बिटवीन इंडियन स्टेट्स इज दैट ओके यस सो मोस्ट कॉमन कॉज ऑफ कॉन्फ्लिक्ट वाज टेरिटोरियल एक्सपेंशन टेरिटोरियल एक्सपेंशन इज वन ऑफ द मेजर कॉजेज टेरिटोरियल एक्सपेंशन मतलब कि आप अपने रीजन की जो बाउंड्री है उसको एक्सपैंड करना चाह रहे हो. यू वांट टू टेरिटोरियली एक्सपैंड, राइट? व्हाई डू यू वांट टू टेरिटोरियली एक्सपैंड? बिकॉज यू वांट मोर रेवेन्यू. आपको लैंड से क्या चाहिए? लैंड इटसेल्फ इज नथिंग, बट अ लैंड विच इज प्रोडक्टिव, जहां से आप रेवेन्यू ले सकते हो, ठीक है, या उस लैंड को आप प्रोडक्टिव बनाइए जहां से आप रेवेन्यू ले सकते हैं. सो दैट इज समथिंग दैट दीज इंडियन स्टेट्स वर इंटरेस्टेड इन. And why do they need revenue? Because internally, a state's ability to generate revenue had reached its limits. All right? Fresh revenue was to be generated by acquiring new territories. Okay? States' ability, different Indian states' ability to generate revenue had somewhere stagnated. It had reached its limit. And for getting more revenue, they had to be involved in new states, in new regions, in new territories. So there was constant conflict between the Indian states, all right, within the Indian state, between the Indian states for territorial expansion, right? All right. So Indian states formed alliance against common enemies such as Nizams, Marathas, and East India Company against Mysore. Alliances were made just to suit the situation. Now, agar alliance ki baat ki jaye at this point of time, alliance matlab jo neetiyan jo aapki alliances ho rahi hain, meaning two people are forming treaties, two states or regions are forming treaties, it is just about suiting each other's interests, right? It wasn't for the larger good, but it was to just suit that situation. So when we see Mysore, for example, Mysore region mein British ko kyun interest tha? We will see that later. Of course, Mysore commercially bahut important hai, strategically bahut important hai, trade ke liye bahut important hai. Aur ek aap baat aur dhyan rakhiye ki Mysore mein French factory already hai. French East India Company ne wahan pe already wahan pe presence hai. और ब्रिटिश और फ्रेंच, आप अगर यूरोपियन कॉन्टेक्स्ट में जानेंगे तो दे वर ऑलवेज बीन एनिमीज. दे फॉट मेनी वॉर्स इन द वर्ल्ड, इन द वर्ल्ड हिस्ट्री यू विल सी, राइट? सो द टेंशन दैट हैपेंस बिटवीन ब्रिटिश एंड फ्रेंच, और ये क्योंकि ये रीजन जो है वो फ्रेंच, माइसोर रीजन में फ्रेंच का प्रेजेंस ऑलरेडी है, वो प्रॉब्लम create kar wo is one of the reasons why British wants that area to be controlled by them. Okay, so keep these broad things in mind. Of course, in one lecture I can't explain everything to you, but you can go back to your learning material. It has been given quite in detail that Mysore regions ki apne dynamics hain, apni wahan ki situations hain, like Bengal ki apne dynamics the us region ki, Mysore aur Maratha aur Maharashtra ke apne dynamics hain jo aapko pata hone chahiye. You should know while you're studying the region or you're studying the historical developments of that region. So reasons for British intervention in Mysore and Maharashtra, or Maharashtra when I say, I mean the Maratha region, the broadly, you know, the present Maharashtra basically, which was a seat of the Marathas, right? And Maratha states was commercial and strategic. All right, why strategic and commercial? Because for example, the spice trade of Malabar coast, so I'm now moving from the eastern coast, hamara jo eastern coast hai usse ab hum move kar rahe hain western coast mein Maratha and in regions pe hum focus kar rahe hain, right? So the spice trade of Malabar coast, the cotton trade through Bombay, you know, all of these were important to be controlled. It had to be controlled because these were important sources of revenue for controlling to become more powerful. So British were now interested in these regions for not only commercial purposes but also strategic matlab important a critical jagah pe ye regions jo hai unki geography located hai. So threat to English East India Company from French in collusion with the native Indian states, especially Mysore. So let me tell you that French presence in Mysore was already there, and the Mysore ki jo rulers hain, they had a very good relation with the rulers. The rulers of Mysore had very good relation with the French East India Company. So and this was something that was becoming a threat to the Britishers, British East India Company. So it wanted to remove the French presence or take control of that region. That means take control of the Mysore ruler so that it can dominate in that region. And of course, keep in mind the British and French rivalry, jo unki dushmani hai in the world European context, right? So Tipu Sultan, who was an active correspondence with French, now that was something that Britishers did not like it, and it wanted to conquer that region or take control of Mysore because of these reasons that I just mentioned. Now let's look at, this is more descriptive and based on events, but I would just like to mention, because it's mentioned in your syllabus and it's also an important events that go around in this period, the Mysore War. There were four wars that were fought. First Anglo-Mysore War, in which Hyder Ali attacked Madras. Madras was also one of the important provinces of the presidency of the British. Okay, so Hyder Ali had attacked Madras, and Nizam of Hyderabad was frequently, so the Hyderabad's provincial governor was called the Nizam of Hyderabad. Like for example, Bengal provincial governor was called Nawab. Hyderabad ka jo provincial jo governor hai wo Nizam, usko title diya jata hai. The Nizam of Hyderabad was frequently switching alliances between East India Company and Mysore. So you see, now there is also a lot of politics that's playing now. So Hyderabad Nizam is now sometimes with the English East India Company and sometimes with the Mysore, Mysore ruler. Yeah, whatever is suiting him. So East India Company had to settle for peace after Hyder Ali's attack on Madras and Treaty of Madras was. So basically the first Anglo-Mysore War was in favor of Mysore, where East India Company had to settle for peace. It had to agree to the terms of Hyder Ali, and Treaty of Madras was signed in Madras. A second Anglo-Mysore War, which took place in 1780 to 84, midway during the war year, Hyder Ali, jo hai, Mysore ke ruler, he passed away, and mantle was on his son Tipu Sultan. Now Tipu Sultan is one of the very popular and figures of the national movement and of this region. I'm sure all of you are familiar with. War years saw fortune fluctuating between both powers. The result was Treaty of Mangalore that maintained the status quo. So again, second Anglo-Mysore War was not very decisive. Na wo British ko favor kiya East India Company ko, na hi it favored the Mysore, as in the ruler of Mysore, the region of Mysore. And basically, peace was made with the signing of Treaty of Mangalore in 1784. The third Anglo-Mysore War, which took place in 1790 to 92, British forces commanded by Lord Cornwallis. Now, here comes a important event. Now, Lord Cornwallis, who was the Governor General of Bengal, was posted now to Mysore to fight on behalf of the British forces. An alliance was made between Nizam, which is Nizam of Hyderabad, Marathas and East India Company. So this was called the Triple Alliance between the Nizam of Hyderabad, the Maratha Sardars and the East India, English East India Company. And they made an alliance to attack Mysore. So Mysore was attacked from all sides. War was decisively fought and peace was brought by the Treaty of Seringapatna. Now with decisively fought, that I mean that of course Mysore was defeated because this Triple Alliance was a powerful alliance and Mysore was attacked from all sides, and Treaty of Seringapatnam was signed. Now what were the points of Treaty of Seringapatnam? Please look at your resource when you study them from your learning e-resource. After that, the fourth Anglo-Mysore War was fought in 1799. Now this was initiated because of French threat to East India Company. Now I had already mentioned that France or England mein hamesha ek war raha hai, ek battle raha hai, ek tension rahi hai. Aur jo tension Europe mein hai unke beech mein, that has somewhere culminated in India. Matlab ladai unki Europe mein ho rahi hai, jhagda wo jo hai, battle war wo jo kar rahe hai, wo Indian subcontinent, Indian territory pe kar rahe hai. Ye bhi ek major characteristic hai France or India ke relation, England or France ke relationship ka. टेंशन उनकी हमेशा से रही है, बट वो टेंशन जो है इंडियन सब कॉन्टिनेंट पर उन्होंने ये वॉर्स फाइट करके अननेसेसरी इंडियन इकोनॉमी को ड्रेन किया है. सो इट वॉज इनिशिएटेड बिकॉज ऑफ फ्रेंच थ्रेट टू द EIC. And of course, the result of 1799 Fourth Anglo-Mysore War was a defeat and death of Tipu Sultan. Territories of Mysore were shared among the members of Triple Alliance. So this was after this, region of Mysore was under the British East India Company. And Triple Alliance, jo the Nizam Maratha, jo part the, unko kuch territories East India Company ne di. Now, coming to Marathas, you know, Maratha Wars. Again, there were three Maratha wars. When I say Anglo, I mean British and Maratha. They fought with each other. There were three Anglo-Maratha wars that were fought. Now, before I go on to explaining ये कि तीन ये Anglo-Maratha war क्या थे, हम समझते हैं कि Maratha क्या थे. Who were these Marathas? क्योंकि Maratha Maratha polity was a system of confederacy. Confederacy means छोटे छोटे regions, छोटे छोटे states साथ में एक union बनाए हुए हैं. They have formed a confederacy. It's called confederacy. और उस confederacy का head जो है वो है Peshwa. ठीक है? With Peshwa as the head. So Shivaji of course is no more there. After Shivaji, there was a problem कि कौन बनेगा. शिवाजी को कोई replace तो कर नहीं सका और ना ही उसके बाद जो लड़ाई हुई शिवाजी की family. Now again, I don't want to go too much in the details of the Marathas and their polity, but फिर पेशवा शिव बनाई गई. अब पेशवा जो है, जो पेशवा होगा, the पेशवा is a head. Now ऐसा नहीं है कि एक ही family से वो पेशवा होगा. पेशवा could be from any Maratha Sardar's family, but पेशवा वही बनेगा जो एक कंसेंट, एक यूनानिमस कंसेंट, एक कंसेंट मतलब कि सब अग्री कर रहे हैं कि ये पेशवा एज अ हेड है. ठीक है? सो अब अग्री करना सबको कि एक ही पेशवा या वो हेड बनेगा इज अ प्रॉब्लम. डिस्प्यूट तो वहां आएगा ही, क्योंकि हर फैमिली चाहेगी मराठा सरदार की कि हमारे से पेशवा हो. सक्सेशन डिस्प्यूट्स होंगे ही फॉर पेशवा शिव. So Maratha polity was a system of confederacy with Peshwa as the head. Succession dispute for Peshwaship was there, and there were also internal struggles among Maratha sardars. और ये सारी जो internal struggles रही हैं Marathas के, Maratha sardars के बीच में, उसने सिर्फ Marathas को weaken किया है, कमजोर बनाया है. क्या कमजोर बनाया है? उनकी एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन को, प्रशासन को, और जो एक कोहेसिवनेस है, मतलब एक स्ट्रेंथ जो एक मराठा एम्पायर की शिवाजी के अंडर थी, वो नहीं रही. वो यूनिटी जो है, वो कोहेसिवनेस, वो स्ट्रेंथ जो है, वो खत्म हो गई. पेशवाशिप में तो वो बिल्कुल ही धीरे धीरे, बिकॉज ऑफ इंटरनल स्ट्रगल्स, इट वॉज कंप्लीटली डिक्लाइनिंग. ठीक है? सो ये चीजें आप दिमाग में रखिए व्हेन यू डिस्कसिंग अबाउट मराठा वॉर्स. Now let's look at the first Anglo-Maratha war, which was fought between 1775 to 82. Now this was a dispute over Peshwaship led Raghunath Rao to get into agreement with Bombay government of EIC. Okay, अब ये क्योंकि इनके अब खुद के इतने internal struggles हैं मराठा सरदार के, तो अब मराठा सरदार एक दूसरे को हराने के लिए East India Company का सहारा ले रहे हैं. अब इसमें देखिए, फर्स्ट एंग्लो मराठा वॉर जब लड़ा गया, वो क्यों लड़ा गया? क्योंकि रघुनाथ राव वो पेशवाशिप के डिस्प्यूट में इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी, जो बॉम्बे प्रोविंस की है, बॉम्बे प्रेसिडेंसी की है, उसको बोल रही है कि भाई हमें मदद कीजिए, आप यू हेल्प अस, राइट? सो डिस्प्यूट ओवर पेशवाशिप लेड रघुनाथ राव टू गेट इनटू अग्रीमेंट विद बॉम्बे गवर्नमेंट ऑफ EIC, एंड द रिजल्ट वॉज द फर्स्ट एंग्लो मराठा वॉर. War remained unfruitful. After a period of 7 years, peace was ensued by a treaty of Salbai. Peace for 20 years with Marathas proved decisive for British in their struggle against the state of Mysore and French. Marathas spent these 20 years in internal squabbles, rupturing the bond that existed between the Sardars. Confederate chiefs went to war against each other, thereby exposing the internal weaknesses of Maratha state. So, because the Maratha Sardars were fighting amongst each other, and to defeat each other, they were taking support of the East India Company, because East India Company would promise ki, "Haan, aap hume, you take our help and we will make you the next Peshwa." So, it was literally playing around with the tensions that was already there in the among the Maratha Sardars. Now, the second Anglo-Maratha war, which happened between 1803 to 5, it defeat of Peshwa Bajirao II by Maratha Sardar Holkar of Indore and led the Peshwas to approach the Governor General Lord Wellesley for help. Peshwa accepted subsidiary alliance treaty and signed Treaty of Bassein. British forces defeated large armies of Maratha Sardars. Abrupt recall of Wellesley brought the war to hold in 1805. So, dekhi, isme it's a little complicated, complex rather, that Lord Wellesley was invited by the one of the Maratha Sardars that help us. We can't come to peace from in the fight that all of us are Maratha Sardars are having. So, and then Lord Wellesley intervened. Peshwa accepted the subsidiary alliance. We will understand what is the subsidiary alliance treaty in the due course of our lecture. And Treaty of Bassein was signed. And Lord Wellesley was called by the British government, and the war came to hold in 1805. Now, the third Anglo-Maratha war, which was fought in between 1817 to 19, it was humiliating terms for subsidiary alliance. That means the war was fought, and the Maratha Sardars, most of them had to accept subsidiary alliance. Now, what is subsidiary alliance? What is humiliating about the subsidiary alliance? We will understand it in the due course of our lecture, but just keep this in your mind for now. This encouraged the Peshwa to make his last attempt to rally together Maratha chiefs. In the war, all chiefs defeated and made to sign subsidiary alliance. Maratha Confederacy was dissolved and Peshwaship was abolished. So you see what can internal fights lead to. Marathas were fighting with each other, the Sardars are fighting each other, they took help of the Britishers time to time, but the underlying motive of the Britishers to even help one Maratha Sardar was to gradually take control of the entire Maharashtra region. And that's what happened. Eventually, all the Maratha Sardars had to accept subsidiary alliance. सब्सिडरी अलायंस के नाते के का एक इम्पॉर्टेंट प्रिंसिपल ये है, एक इम्पॉर्टेंट कंडीशन है कि आपको इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी ब्रिटिश गवर्नमेंट आपकी सुपीरियोरिटी को एक्सेप्ट करना है. And there were other things also that we will know gradually. So all the Maratha chiefs had to accept the subsidiary alliance, and Maratha Confederacy was dissolved and Peshwaship was abolished. Okay. Now this was about Mysore. Ki kaise gradually Mysore ko aur kaise gradually Maharashtra aur Maratha region ko, aur usse pehle humne dekha ki kaise gradually Bengal ko eastern coast mein कैसे ब्रिटिशर्स ने धीरे धीरे अपने अधीन कर लिया. इट टुक कंट्रोल ऑफ दीज रीजन्स. सो नाउ इट हैज बोथ द ईस्टर्न कोस्ट एंड इट हैज द वेस्टर्न कोस्ट. ओके, नाउ लेट अस सी दैट ये सब्सिडरी अलायंस और डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ लैप्स था क्या. कहने के लिए ये डिप्लोमेसी था, एंड इट वॉज एन एक्सपेंशन थ्रू डिप्लोमेसी. दैट मीन्स आप भी बेनिफिट कीजिए, मैं भी बेनिफिट करेंगे, हम भी बेनिफिट करेंगे. बट इट द रियल सेंस दिस डिप्लोमेसी ओनली फेवर्ड एंड benefited the Britishers. So what is the subsidiary alliance system? It was extremely advantageous system for British, with which they could become paramount power. Now, paramount power is a very important word. Abhi tak maine ye shabd paramount power use nahi kiya tha. Paramount matlab sabse upar, aap sabse zyada powerful hai. Britishers have now become extremely powerful. They are the paramount power. आप क्वेश्चन नहीं कर सकते. नो इंडियन स्टेट कैन क्वेश्चन दिस पैरामाउंट पावर. अ ट्रीटी और अग्रीमेंट बिटवीन इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी एंड एन इंडियन स्टेट एंड निजाम ऑफ हैदराबाद वाज फर्स्ट टू साइन दिस अलायंस इन 1798. सो देखिए, बाय द एंड ऑफ 18th सेंचुरी वी ऑलमोस्ट हैव स्टेट्स लाइक निजाम ऑफ हैदराबाद साइनिंग दिस ट्रीटी. That means they have given up on their independence and now they accept English East India Company as the paramount power. What were the features of the subsidiary alliance? So there are six broad points. That means that these six principles have to be accepted by the Indian state. For example, if a Maratha state is accepting subsidiary alliance, it has to accept these 6-7 points, these 6-7 conditions. What are they? First, company recognized as paramount power. That means English East India Company was now recognized as a paramount power by the native states, the state that signs this subsidiary alliance system. British residence was appointed by East India Company in the native Indian state. That means that British official, a British resident क्यों resident मतलब वो उस region में रहेगा, उस state में रहेगा. For example, अगर निजाम ऑफ हैदराबाद ने alliance sign किया है 1798 में, हैदराबाद में एक British official वहाँ reside करेगा, वहाँ रहेगा. And this British official was appointed by EIC, East India Company. और वो उसका वो रहेगा कहाँ? वो हैदराबाद में रहेगा और हैदराबाद कोर्ट में उसकी एक इम्पोर्टेंट पोजिशन रहेगी. ठीक है, ब्रिटिश रेजिडेंट वॉज अपॉइंटेड बाई EIC इन द नेटिव इंडियन स्टेट्स. EIC टू प्रोटेक्ट द रूलर फ्रॉम इंटरनल एंड एक्सटर्नल थ्रेट्स. मतलब इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी प्रॉमिस कर रही है कि रूलर को, इंडियन रूलर को जो ये अलायंस साइन कर रहे हैं, कि हम आपको प्रोटेक्ट करेंगे कोई भी बाहर की थ्रेट से, एक्सटर्नल थ्रेट से, या कोई इंटरनल अगर प्रॉब्लम है उससे ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी विल प्रोटेक्ट द नेटिव स्टेट. रूलर ऑफ इंडियन स्टेट कुड नॉट मेंटेन एनी डिप्लोमेटिक रिलेशंस विद एनी इंडियन स्टेट और फॉरेन पावर. जो नेटिव स्टेट है वो कोई भी इंडियन स्टेट कोई भी दूसरे स्टेट के साथ कोई भी डिप्लोमेटिक रिलेशनशिप नहीं रख सकती, कोई भी इंडियन स्टेट के साथ डिप्लोमेटिक रिलेशनशिप नहीं रख सकती, एंड नाइदर कैन इट हैव एनी रिलेशन विद अ फॉरेन पावर. दैट मींस फ्रेंच, डच, इंग्लिश, फ्रेंच, डच, पोर्चुगीज या और भी कोई. इंग्लिश के साथ तो रहेगा बिकॉज इंग्लिश के साथ साइन किया हुआ है अलायंस, बट और कोई फॉरेन पावर के साथ द इंडियन स्टेट, दैट इंडियन स्टेट कैन नॉट साइन एनी अग्रीमेंट, कैन नॉट बी इन एनी डिप्लोमेटिक रिलेशनशिप. फिफ्थ, द रूलर हैड टू पे फॉर एक्सपेंसेस ऑफ द ब्रिटिश आर्मी स्टेशन्ड इन हिज स्टेट. नाउ दिस वॉज वेरी वेरी हार्ड ऑन द नेटिव स्टेट्स. इसका मतलब क्या है कि एक इंग्लिश रेजिडेंट तो है ही आपके रीजन में, एक ब्रिटिश आर्मी भी आपके स्टेट में स्टेशन रहेगी. द इंडियन स्टेट विच हैज साइन दिस सब्सिडरी अलायंस विल हैव टू मेंटेन अ ब्रिटिश आर्मी, अ ट्रूप ऑफ ब्रिटिश आर्मी इन हिज रीजन. और जो उस ब्रिटिश आर्मी के एक्सपेंसेस हैं, दैट विल बी बोर्न बाय, दैट विल हैव टू बी टेकन केयर बाय द दैट इंडियन स्टेट, दैट नेटिव स्टेट. नेटिव आर्मी ऑफ द रूलर वॉज टू बी डिसबैंडेड. जो नेटिव आर्मी है, जो उस इंडियन स्टेट की, नेटिव स्टेट की जो आर्मी है, उसको बोला गया कि अभी आर्मी नहीं रहेगी. इट वॉज डिसबैंडेड क्योंकि ब्रिटिश आर्मी आ गई है. अब आपकी लोकल जो आपकी रीजन की आर्मी है, दैट वॉज टू बी डिसबैंडेड. मतलब कि अब वो आर्मी नहीं रहेगी. सो दीज वर वेरी हार्श एंड ह्यूमिलिएटिंग टर्म्स फॉर द इंडियन स्टेट्स अंडर द सब्सिडरी अलायंस सिस्टम. आप खुद समझ सकते हैं कि ये अलायंस के जो पॉइंट्स मैंने आपको बताया है, इसके कारण जो है आप अपनी इंडिपेंडेंस तो लूज कर ही रहे हैं, बट इट इज ऑल्सो ह्यूमिलिएटिंग, इंसल्टिंग फॉर द नेटिव स्टेट्स हु वर इंडिपेंडेंट, दे वर इंडिपेंडेंट रूलर्स. बट नाउ अ ट्रेडिंग कंपनी हैज फोर्स, हैज पुट दीज कंडीशंस एंड इन इट्स ट्रीटी विद यू. सो इट्स मोर देन financially draining, it's also very very humiliating for the Indian states. Iske merits kya hai, humne abhi tak iske demerits hi dekhe hain, but merits agar hain bhi to of course there, that is for the British East India Company. East India Company could maintain a large army without paying for it. Aap ek maintain kar rahe ho army states mein, different states mein maintain kar rahe ho Indian states mein, and you don't have to pay for it because the Indian states are paying for it. Control administration of the state. Who is controlling the East India Company? किसके थ्रू? द ब्रिटिश रेजिडेंट, जो आपके जो इन इंडियन स्टेट्स के कोर्ट में ब्रिटिश रेजिडेंट पोस्टेड है, वो कॉन्स्टेंटली इंटरफियर कर रहा है इंडियन स्टेट्स के पॉलिटिक्स में, उस रीजन के पॉलिटिक्स में. और उसके थ्रू ब्रिटिश गवर्नमेंट जो है वो उस एरिया के, उस रीजन के, उस स्टेट के एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन को कंट्रोल कर पा रही है. British, of course, became the paramount power. British could effectively deal with threat of any foreign power, especially French in India. So I told you that British and French had their own rivalries, and British always was anti-French, and French had already made establishments in India before the English East India Company also came. And the way subsidiary alliance was made, it also was like a check on these foreign powers who could not now establish a very strong control in India. If any ruler could not pay for expense of the British army, it had to cede territories. So if a native ruler says that, no, I can't pay for your British army, it's too expensive, I don't have that much revenue, then that native Indian state had to give up some territories of his region. That was even more harsh. Now, demerits were that native rulers literally lost their independence. Lakhs of soldiers were unemployed because a native army was disbanded. Uske karan jo soldiers the, unki naukriyan chali gayi. Ruler lost all incentive for good governance because the governance now came in direct control of these East India Company officials, and ruler really lost all incentive for any good governance because it would not matter. Ultimately, the decision makers were now the English East India Company and the British government. Okay, so these were some important discussions on the subsidiary alliance system. Let's look at another treaty which the Britishers call as diplomatic treaty. I mean ki English East India Company jo hai wo acquire karna cha rahi hai dusre territories. Subsidiary alliance ke madhyam se bhi wo acquire kar rahi hai, बट ऑलमोस्ट इनडायरेक्टली कोशिश कर रही है एक्वायर करने की. पर डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ लैप्स से वो डायरेक्ट ऑक्यूपेशन कर रही है कुछ इंडियन नेटिव रीजन्स का. सो इट वॉज एन ऑक्यूपेशनल पॉलिसी अप्लाइड बाय द इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी टू एक्वायर एंड एनेक्स टेरिटरीज. राइट, मेन इंटेंशन वॉज कमर्शियल, टू प्रमोट ब्रिटिश एक्सपोर्ट्स टू द नेटिव स्टेट्स. Okay, now this policy was not invented or conceived. हमें लगता है कि लॉर्ड डलहौजी ने ये इन्वेंट की थी ये पॉलिसी, और या उसकी ये सोच है, ये डॉक्ट्रिन ऑफ लैप्स उसकी सोच है, पर ये गलत है. ये ऑलरेडी पॉलिसी थी और लॉर्ड डलहौजी ने इसको अप्लाई किया इंडियन स्टेट्स पे. Okay, so Lord Dalhousie applied it vigorously wherever he could. So when Lord Dalhousie was the Governor General of India, he had applied this doctrine of lapse wherever he could, because through this doctrine of lapse, he was able to annex, acquire Indian regions, Indian native states. Okay, so according to this doctrine of lapse, kya tha ye doctrine of lapse? A princely state would be annexed by the English East India Company if the ruler was incompetent or died without a natural heir. There were two points to it. Agar East India Company ko lage ki lag raha hai ki ek Indian native ruler apni region ko dhang se manage nahi kar raha hai, mal administration ho rahi hai, incompetently manage kar raha hai, so English East India Company us gunah par, us condition par ki aap manage nahi kar rahe ho apna native state, उस रीजन को एनेक्स कर लेगी. और दूसरा रीजन ये है दैट इफ एन इंडियन नेटिव रूलर डाइज विदाउट अ नेचुरल हेयर, व्हेन आई से नेचुरल हेयर, उसका खुद का अगर कोई बच्चा नहीं है, अ सन, व्हेन आई से नेचुरल हेयर इट मींस द सन, देन आल्सो द इंग्लिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी वुड एनेक्स दैट रीजन. So there were two situations. First, that if you are incompetently managing the your state, or if you die, if one dies without a natural heir. In both these situations, or in either of these situations, the English East India Company can annex your state. So this policy denied the right of Indian ruler to even adopt an heir, contrary to the Indian tradition. So we know the famous case of Jhansi. So when the ruler of Jhansi was not allowed to adopt a successor, and that led to, of course, the fight between the Rani Jhansi, who carried her adopted son and fought the Britishers. Yes, so so Jhansi was wanted. Jhansi was taken under doctrine of lapse by Lord Dalhousie under because there was no natural heir, right? So so they were very very difficult, harsh. These are very harsh terms that were applied on the Indian states. Very humiliating, and their natural rights and their customary traditional rights were completely taken from them. Even they could not even adopt an heir if they didn't have one, a natural heir. So if you really think about them, they were extremely humiliating and difficult, more than difficult, in fact, terms that were that were put on the Indian states through doctrine of lapse and subsidiary alliance. And many Indian states lost their sovereignty and became part of the British territories. It led to a lot of unrest among Indian princes, and it was one of the major reasons for the cause of revolt of 1857. So before 1850, by 1857, a number of Indian native states were annexed or taken control by the British East India Company through subsidiary alliance and doctrine of lapse. And all of this would not make the Indian princes happy. They were extremely troubled. There was a lot of unrest in their regions. There was a lot of tension, a lot of sadness, and anxiety and panic. And all of this was because the British wanted to take Indian territories under control. And they did this through doctrine of lapse and subsidiary alliance. And gradually, there was so much of anger and dissatisfaction among the Indian princes that revolt of 1857 saw later. We will see that in our next lecture, we will see that how revolt of 1857 did see a number of Indian princes and Indian ruling houses fighting against the British rule. Right. So I would just like to end my lecture here. And broadly, we have today taken a look at, you know, these three broad themes: the Plassey, Buxar battle, and which made the Britishers literally the rulers of Bengal. And we also saw the regions of Mysore and Maharashtra on the eastern coast and how they were conquered gradually. And how what the Britishers call as a diplomacy, they were literally expanding and annexing territories on the pretext of subsidiary alliance and doctrine of lapse. Now, there are a lot of details that are already there in your e-resource, and I would really encourage all of you to, you know, look at that. And I would like to now end my lecture here and request Dr. Sakir to take control. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Tripti. If the students have any questions or query, they may ask directly to Ms. Deo, or they may write their questions in the chat box. We have a 5 minutes time for that. If anyone asks to questions to Ms. Deo, they may ask. यदि कहार क्वेश्चन पचारिबार अच्छे से क्वेश्चन पचारि परिबे किंबा चैट बॉक्स रे निजर क्वेश्चन लिखि परिबे
इज देयर एनी क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम इन द चैट बॉक्स Not as of
now. No, not yet. I have not seen any question in the chat box.
I hope the lecture wasn't too difficult to understand.
If there is no questions, now I will request our Professor Pradeep Pawan Mishra to comment on this topic, please. Professor Mishra, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Sakir. And Mrs. Tripti Deo. Once again, our history faculty is indebted to you for your lectures. So, I mean, illuminating. And this is your, I think, 7th or 8th lecture. And tomorrow you are speaking also. And as far as the British conquest of our nation is concerned, I mean, it's one of the examples how a trading company became the political masters of the nation through devious diplomacy, through cessionary, through corruption. 1757 is not only important from military viewpoint because British won the battle, and another important thing is that before that they had vanquished the French after the 7 years war, and the events that followed 1757 is still more important because the company's blitzkrieg never stopped. It went on. And 1764, the Battle of Buxar, is still more important because legally the company got the financial rights of revenue collection in the areas of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa. And from that time onwards, the trend of wealth started. India became a poor nation, and the British not only drained India of its wealth, but also gradually they became the political masters after 1764. And one of the examples is the subsidiary alliance, then the doctrine of Lapps that you had already spoken. And with this, once again, thank you, Mrs. Deo, and thank you very much, everybody present here. Thank you.
Thank you. So if there's any question, my email address is already on the website, so they can write me a question, I can reply to them. Agar Odia mein likhna chahe to aap Odia mein bhi likh sakte hain, Hindi mein likhna chahe ya Angrezi mein, and I will reply in the language that you write your question in. So please feel free to ask to write any question agar koi hai aapke liye padhne ke baad. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Agnesia, for your kindness.
Thank
and,
you.
If there is no questions, now I would like to request Nishant to stop the recording.